Hey, what's going on, everyone? It's Walt here from Down the Block Sports, and today I want to talk about the NBA. The trade deadline is February 10th at 3 p.m. Eastern, so what we're going to talk about today is some trade candidates, specifically one who has the chance to make the Eastern Conference All-Star team here in 2022. My guest on the show today, Kyle Russo from Review and Preview Sports. Kyle, welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me back on, Alec. Happy to be here, man. I know it's been a while, but starting off the new year hot with some NBA trade talk.
Absolutely, man. So we talk about that all-star that could be on the trade block. Mm-hmm. I did one video before on one of his teammates, Miles Turner. If you want to check that out on Down the Block Sports, feel free to check out that video after this. The trade candidate we're talking about today is Domantas Sabonis. You know, you go into the offseason, you add Rick Carlisle, you have arguably the best front court in basketball. Yes, they were waiting for some injuries to come back. We have not seen TJ Warren this year. Caris LeVert's been in and out of the lineup. Malcolm Brogdon currently isn't in the lineup. Kyle, the entire NBA is dealing with COVID-19 problems. But if you were to tell me at the beginning of the season that on January 5th, as we record, the Indiana Pacers would be 14-24 on a 5-game losing streak. They're playing Brooklyn as we speak, so that number could change as our listeners are listening to the show. I tell you, you're freaking crazy. What is going on this year with the Indiana Pacers?
I have no idea, Alec, to be honest with you. You know, the addition of Rick Carlisle, I thought that was really supposed to solidify their head coaching matters after their previous coach. I think they, and then when they hired Carlisle,
he was not successful.
But I thought that when they hired Carlisle, you know, again, there's nothing so flashy about the players in Indiana, but they got a really solid roster, from top down. Sabonis, LeVert, Brogdon, you got McConnell on the bench, you got TJ Warren whenever he comes back.
Duarte,
who at one point in time was looking like the rookie of the year. I know he's kind of slowly dipped down number-wise, but I don't really know what's wrong with this roster. And me and you, before we started the show here, we were kind of rolling through the roster to see, like, if anybody's missed significant time due to injury or COVID, and really the only person who's missed time is TJ Warren. He hasn't played a game this season, so you can't really count that. But nobody else has really missed any significant amount of time outside of TJ Warren. So you say to yourself, well, what could possibly be the cause? And then just looking at their schedule and what they've done this season, the biggest thing that I've seen, Alec, is just that they cannot close out games. In fact, in the month of October, because they've been bad since day one, they started off the month of October 1-6. So they've been bad since the start of the season. This isn't just a problem that just occurred and Indiana's been sliding. They're only ahead of two teams in the Eastern Conference right now, the Detroit Pistons and I believe the Orlando Magic, who each have seven wins. So that's
exciting.
You know, this is a team that, with an expanded playoff nonetheless, and a team that has playoff caliber players and really, really good players overall, especially in Brogdon and especially in Domantas Sabonis, it's really questionable why they're as bad as they are.
Yeah, well, when you see teams struggling in the NBA and, you know, Sabonis being on the contract, he is one of the best values in all of the NBA. We'll get to that in 1 second. But, you know, when you're 14-24, you have all-star level players on your roster. You know, there's a reason Sabonis' name is in rumors. Now, you know, Kyle, when you look at Sabonis' contract, he's owed $18.5 million in this season. Next season, he's owed $19.9 million. The following season, $21.3 million. In today's NBA, for non-rookie contracts, that might be one of the best values, if not the best value in the NBA. I mean, this guy is 100%. An all-star level talent. Barely making $20 million. I know $20 million is a lot of money, but in a league where players are making 30, 40, some into 50, this is a steal.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, that's probably, I mean, you're reading those numbers off to me. That has to be top five best contracts in the entire NBA for the value which Domantas Sabonis adds to your team.
His teammate Miles Turner is 18-18 for this year and next. That's another good contract there in Indiana.
Indiana's done a great job of managing their contracts, too. I don't know about Brogdon, but I'm pretty sure he's on another really good valued contract for what he contributes to the table as well. Indiana's done a great job, but the problem with is, if anything, it's in their benefit. Again, you don't want to see a team do this poorly, especially with the roster that they've assembled, because they've done a really good job at assembling the roster in which they had. because most of these guys are not their guys, right? They brought over Malcolm Brogdon from Milwaukee because they decided to go elsewhere in terms of their signing. I believe they gave Chris Middleton the contract that year instead of adding Brogdon. With Milwaukee, you have Caris LeVert, who was in the trade with Brooklyn. You add a guy in Sabonis, who was originally in OKC when they did the Paul George trade. None of these guys that are really their star, McConnell, who was an addition from the 76ers as a free agent, none of these guys are their guys, but they've built the team very, very well. And the fact that it's not succeeding is a head scratcher, because on paper, that's a really good roster. Again, I don't think that's winning you an NBA championship, but that should at least be what? Maybe a fifth, sixth seed in the Eastern Conference right now?
Yeah.
No, and it really doesn't make any sense to why they're this bad.
Yeah. I mean, maybe if they were, you know, in the wild card or maybe played a play-in game,
it wouldn't
terribly surprise me. You know, you look at Chicago, Brooklyn, you know, some other teams at the top of the Eastern Conference. There are some other quality teams in this league, but with an experienced head coach and a quality roster, it just has not been the season we expected out of the Indiana Pacers in 2021-2022. Now, when you look at the rest of this roster, LeVert has 2 years remaining on his contract. Warren's contract expires at the end of the year. Same with Jeremy Lamb. Justin Holiday, two more seasons. They have some other guys who could potentially move. I don't really know what they could get with their pieces to build around Sabonis, but when you look at Sabonis' trade value, it is extremely high right now, and there's a lot of teams around the NBA who could use a piece like Domantas Sabonis. Kyle, we're going to talk about five teams that should get on the phone and call the Indiana Pacers. Let's start with your number five team for Domantas Sabonis.
So my number five team, Alec, and a team in which you brought up to me, that's kind of a quiet on the fence type of team, and obviously you'd know more than I would, I'm going to have to go with the Boston Celtics here. And I'm going to have to go with the Boston Celtics because it feels like they're another team, like they're another season away completing this season from completely blowing it up themselves. And I feel like Sabonis can be that X factor into the equation for Boston that will make them something to be special. Again, they haven't really figured out how to use Jason Tatum and Jaylen Brown on the court properly. Marcus Smart, essentially, you know what you're getting in him. The Dennis Schroeder experiment, you'd know better than I would, but I wouldn't say that it's necessarily working out that well. Al Horford has been a nice reunion back to Boston, but another factor, an older player, but nothing for the long term. Sabonis is a guy you just read it yourself. That's a guy you could have on a nice contract for the next 3 years, and the value in which he brings to the table as a rebounder, as a pure scorer, the way he's able to play the game. And again, defensively as well in the paint, that's hard to score on what, a 6'11", 7-foot guy? They don't have that right now. I mean, Robert Williams is great, don't get me wrong, but people forget that Robert Williams is also what, like 6'9"? He's not the biggest of guys in the paint. And although he's a good player, he doesn't contribute the way that Sabonis would offensively, nor in the paint rebounding-wise, on top of the fact Sabonis, the one thing throughout his career that he's had on his side is that he's been an extremely durable player, while Robert Williams has not been that, has been far from that. And I know that they gave Robert Williams an extension in the offseason, and I don't know if that would be a key acquisition in which would be intriguing for Indiana. Again, another team in which you say that'd be a good landing spot, but what would they get in return? I just think that the Celtics are one of those teams where they really have to make a move, and that's a move that will keep them competitive and will keep their name in the ring for potentially competing in the playoffs. Because right now, the way they're playing, they're not going anywhere. They're not making it out of the first round.
I agree. No, I think the Boston Celtics should absolutely be interested in Domantas Sabonis. They need to improve in the paint. They have some – they're my honorable mention because I truly don't love their assets. I think if I'm Indiana and I'm trading one of the most valuable contracts in the NBA, Marcus Smart and Richardson and Schroeder and maybe some other young guards, Robert Williams, I don't think that gets the deal done. Because when you look at Indiana, I mean, you want to get a young foundational piece. You know, could that be Robert Williams? Maybe, but you already have Miles Turner on your roster. I feel like if you're adding Williams, you're going to have him split minutes with Miles Turner, which is very good, but that's not really taking your franchise to the next level. Smart, again, would join a guard rotation that's pretty deep. I mean, when you look at their young assets, maybe Langford's been better. Pritchard, I think, is the best of the young guards. Grant Williams taking a massive step forward with his shooting in 2021. But when I look at the Boston Celtics, should they be interested? Absolutely, they should be interested. If I'm Indiana, am I looking for those type of assets? Not exactly. So they're my honorable mention. Again, I don't love their trade assets, but if Brad Stevens can find a way to get Domantas Sabonis, you're going to see a wild reaction video on Down the Block Sports. And number five, I have the team that was number one for Miles Turner, and that is the Charlotte Hornets. Now, it's been bothering me to figure out which one I want to pick, but man, if I'm Charlotte, I'm looking for that true second star with the LaMelo Ball. And they were hoping it could be Gordon Hayward. Hayward has been bad, but he's not exactly someone you can rely on. He's not durable at all. Oubre's been solid. Miles Bridges has the chance to be the most improved player of the year. Yes, you heard that rightly, right? When you look at their pieces, obviously James Bouknight would be someone featured. If I'm Indiana, I would love Bridges. I'm not exactly sold that he would be a piece. They have Washington, Kai Jones, some draft picks that are probably going to be, they'll make the playoffs, but they won't be 28, 29, 30. I think they'll be around 18 to 20 when it comes to their draft picks. If they add Sabonis, obviously a future pick, if they were to add any, could be later in the first round. Again, they're not a team that has the most, they're not like again, the Celtics aren't the best assets. They have good assets, not amazing assets. I think they're a little bit better than Boston's. I think they should be 100% aggressive for this, but man, if you get LaMelo Ball and Domantas Sabonis, you know, I even said this with Miles Turner too.
Yeah.
They need a big man badly.
Yeah.
If they could find a way to get aggressive for one of them, I was more favored for Turner in the Turner video, but at number five, man, again, they don't have the young cornerstone star that Indiana would like to receive, but they got some young solid pieces that would definitely interest the Indiana Pacers.
I love that spot for Charlotte, especially because it seems like for a very long time now, even in the Kemba era, it's been a revolving door at the center position, you know, with the years of Bismack Biyombo, and now they did a trade in the offseason for Mason Plumlee. They've drafted guys like PJ Washington and Vernon Carey Jr., and it doesn't seem like anybody's evolving at that true center position that it seems like they're trying to roll with. Yeah. So move on towards a more developed player, a guy who has experience. And while he is a center based on his height and what he could do, he's also a huge contribution in the paint and scoring wise. And that's something they're missing too from their center position. They don't really have that. I think probably their lead scorer, at least at the center position, my guess would be PJ Washington. I know he averaged around 10 points per game at the center position. That would be my guess. But again, to have a guy like Domantas Sabonis, LaMelo Ball, Terry Rozier, Gordon Hayward, Miles Bridges. I mean, that's a sick lineup. That's a sick lineup.
That could win a series.
That could win a series.
It's not being Brooklyn or Milwaukee, but
and the best again, the best part about that, really, with the exception of Gordon Hayward, is that's all youth, and that's all youth for a while. Again, I don't know how old Rozier is. Rozier might be touching 30, but again, for the most part, that's a young lineup.
Yeah,
that's a very young lineup. Yeah. So I like that spot. I do. I actually like it a lot. That was going to be one of my top ones, but I know that we're going in order here. So maybe I'll switch up just to be a little fancy.
We'll go in order. When you have Charlotte, you can mention them again. So here, real quick, let's go to your number four.
My number four. And see, now I don't know if this is kind of a, I don't want to say a pipe dream, but something that I would like to see happen. I'd like to see Sabonis end up in a Knicks uniform. I think that would be kind of an ideal situation, because New York right now, they're in a position where they don't necessarily have an identity. You know, I'm hearing rumors they should, but they don't. You know, they were the fourth seed last year, and with the expanded playoff and with the way that they're playing right now, they're going to essentially be a play-in team unless they make a money move. And the moves that they made in the offseason, again, another team that based on a fourth seed last year in the Eastern Conference, which was amazing. And I'm a New Yorker, Alec. It shocked everybody.
Yeah.
Everybody. And New York, when New York basketball is good, it is some of the most exciting things in sports, especially in the Garden. And the season that Julius Randle had was tremendous. The problem with the team in which they're having now is that they set that bar, they set that expectation, so anything less than that is not okay. Combined with the fact that while Julius Randle is still a great player, he's not as consistent as he was last year. He was the most consistent player. And RJ Barrett, again, people forget how young he is. He's 21 years old. He's 21. Yeah. And he has so much room to grow. He's looking like a good player, but again, in year three, he's still lacking consistency. And where the problem lies is that there's really nothing after that, right? Kemba Walker, the experiment, has shown some brightness at some times, has not been great in others, to the point where he was taken out of lineup completely.
Yeah. Yeah.
You have other guys like Evan Fournier. That looks like a terrible contract right now. It doesn't look like it's going to work out in New York's favor. Mitchell Robinson is a nice player, but again, he's more so a true center. Hasn't really evolved that offensive part of his game.
You know he's not going to be a Nick if Sabonis is a member.
Well, yeah, that will essentially be a guy in the trade. Derrick Rose, I think he's hurt right now. I don't even know if he's playing, but even so, that's not a long-term answer. And some of their guys that they've drafted in the higher rounds have just not necessarily panned out and not really been a good part of the lineup. While I love the Obi Toppin pick while it happened, back 2 years ago, because the New York story, you know, you see the picture with him wearing the New York Knicks uniform to be home, you know, it was a great story. But the player that he is, I don't know if it necessarily fits the window of the Knicks. And I know that might sound weird because the Knicks, I don't think necessarily even have a window right now to even be spoken about. But if you put Domantas Sabonis on that team, and I think essentially what that trade would have to consist of, it would be probably an Obi Toppin, Mitchell Robinson, and maybe a Kemba Walker or Alec Burks with maybe a draft pick or two in there. Because I think that if you're the Knicks, you want to keep Barrett, you want to keep Randall. Again, maybe it'd be tough to kind of figure out how to have Randall and Sabonis on the same, like, on the floor at the same time, because they're essentially the same type of player. Randall just has a better three-point game than Sabonis. But I think that would make a move, that would make a splash move to get a superstar, because I think that's what he is. Like, Sabonis is quietly a superstar because of where he's played in the NBA. Like, a small market team in OKC, Indiana, who's been good, but again, not a lot of people really take them seriously, even when they've been at their best. You put him in New York with an RJ Barrett and a Julius Randle, like, that's a good team. That's a good team. And that'll get the wheel spinning on some wins versus where the Knicks are right now. I think, what are they, Alec? Like the 11th or 10th seed right now?
They are 11. They are 18 and 20.
Yeah. That's nowhere near where they want to be. That's nowhere near where they should be. And I know with an 18 and 20 record at the 11th spot, it sounds like, wow, they're way out of it. But when you really look at the Eastern Conference, they only need a couple more wins underneath their belt, some things to start going their way for them to be in that top five competition in the Eastern Conference. So
yeah,
I think that would be a good move, in my personal opinion.
Let's go to number three here. I'm going to wait for mine because I hope to God it doesn't happen. But we'll start with you here, Kyle.
So this one might come as a little bit of a shocker just because they are a team that doesn't need him at all. But I feel like they have the assets to do it if they really wanted to. My number three team is the Golden State Warriors. And I think why this could be good, and let me explain. They haven't had a legitimate center threat for God knows how long. You know, it's been Kevon Looney now. It was Zaza Pachulia. It was Andrew Bogut. This would throw into the mix not only youth, but a difference maker at the center position. Now, you might be saying to yourself, well, what about James Wiseman? Well, they're doing all this now without him. And even when he played in his rookie year, there was nothing too flashy about his game. And obviously, he's a rookie. There's so much to develop in his game. But what I love about this situation with the Golden State Warriors is that it's not going to affect them at all in a negative way. It's only going to help them in a positive way, adding youth and adding other stuff to their team, scoring options as well. That's only going to help them. On top of the fact, Alec, they have the assets to do so. A trade like this, two lottery picks, you give them a Moses Moody, you give them a James Wiseman, maybe a Kevon Looney in there, and you add a first-round pick in there, that'll get the job done. It's ultimately, if you're Indiana, I think that's probably one of the better trade packages that you could get, potentially, from a team for Domantas Sabonis. Now, it's just a matter of fact, if you just want to pull the trigger, if you're Indiana, and just say, well, the NBA is going to stink for the next couple years because Golden State, nobody's stopping that team now.
Yeah, I mean, I know they have some huge contracts already on the books. I know Sabonis isn't the most expensive, So it'd be interesting to see how they could make that all fit within the tax. I know Wiggins is making a bunch of money, Curry, Thompson, Draymond, guys like that. So if they can make the money work, I think they would obviously be the best. They're already the best team in basketball. You know, that's a bonus to that. My God. Number three, I told you, I hope this doesn't happen. I mean, if Sacramento trades everyone around De'Aaron Fox, what the hell is going to happen with De'Aaron Fox? You know, I look at Sacramento and again, bad team. They really certainly have some assets to move. I mean, if I am Indiana, I want Halliburton. It'd be interesting to see how that works out. Obviously, Marvin Bagley's not happy. Buddy Hield is not happy. Those are some other names we could have seen in a deal. I know they drafted Davion Mitchell in the first round last year. So Sacramento certainly has some pieces that clearly don't want to be in Sacramento for much longer. But if you trade everything around De'Aaron Fox and you don't get the quality return, it seems like De'Aaron Fox is next in line. Sacramento needs to make sure they keep their star player happy because everyone around them isn't. And if they can find a way to add a Sabonis to pair with De'Aaron Fox and Harrison Barnes, I mean, again, I think their ceiling is 6 and maybe even 7 or 8. I think the objective is to find that true piece next to De'Aaron Fox. And I think they do have the assets. I hope to God they don't do it because Sacramento will find a way to screw this up. But I need to be real here. I do think there is a road here with the Kings.
It could be possible. It could be possible. I just think that they're so far away from doing anything. I don't see why they would make that kind of major move type of trade.
It's, again, to appease their star player.
I guess. But he's already locked up for the next, what, 5+ years under contract?
Yeah, but, so, again, if you move what is their trade? Like, again, if they move these pieces and it's De'Aaron Fox, I mean, Halliburton's legit, but and the rest of the roster sucks, what's going to happen in 2 years? They may not make the playoffs 2 straight years. What's going to happen to De'Aaron Fox? That's, I think, true. Sabonis could really be used as a guy to keep other stars happy to prevent a future trade. How Maybe. To keep a star happy? Get him another star.
Very, very possible. It's very possible.
Who do you have for number two, Kyle?
Number two, I have the Dallas Mavericks. And it's because while they sit at number 6 in the Western Conference, there's nothing flashy really about this team, right? Even though you have Luka, Kristaps is having a good year. He's averaging around 20 points per game. But for me, again, you could really never count him necessarily is a true factor just because of the fact that he's so injury prone. And then you have Tim Hardaway Jr. who's only averaging around 14 points per game. I think he's their third leading scorer. Again, I could be completely wrong when I say that. Actually, Jalen Brunson is their third leading scorer with around 16 points per game. But again, nothing
big fan of him.
But nothing too flashy about this team where if you make the playoffs as a 6th seed, who's really scared of Dallas? Are you scared of Dallas or are you scared of just Luka Doncic? I think that if you do a package for Sabonis where you include guys like a Reggie Bullock, a Josh Green, who's only in his first year, a Maxi Kleber, and maybe you add a Kristaps. Now, that would be a discussion to be had if they want to trade a Kristaps Porzingis in that deal, as well as potentially a first-round pick or two. That would be a trade for Dallas that I think they need to make because they need durability. They can't just have Luka out there by himself. While Kristaps has been healthy this year, this has been the first of what? His 6-7 year career now in the NBA that he's healthy.
Yeah.
He could do great things, but I don't know if you can count on that. Domantas Sabonis brings durability to the table, and he brings obviously a rebounding threat and scoring threat.
Yeah. I mean, if Porzingis is not included in the deal, I don't think Dallas has the assets to do it. I didn't hear anything bad about the relationship between Carlisle and Porzingis. Obviously, you need to remember that with them switching teams, him formerly coaching the Dallas Mavericks. Again, I think Dallas should absolutely do it if they can find a way to get him. Luka Doncic's supporting cast is a freaking joke. People don't really talk about it as much because everyone knows Kristaps Porzingis and Luka Doncic is so good they get enough wins anyways to kind of make up for it. But again, I don't see them getting higher than a 6. If they added Sabonis, I mean, I would have to see what the rest of their roster looks like because they're going to have to give up more than Porzingis just to get him. But if Porzingis is not in the deal, I don't think Dallas has a chance. Again, I don't have Dallas on my list because I think their assets are absolutely awful outside of Porzingis. But for my number 2, is that what we're on? 2?
Yeah, we're on 2. 2-2-2.
2, I have the Knicks. Okay. New York, Tom Thibodeau. You know, you have the 2 stars like we mentioned already before. You have some young assets you can move. I'm not fully sold on Mitch Robinson and Thibodeau. I think he wouldn't get too obsessed with New York. I don't think that would bother him too much. Again, he's a quiet guy, so You're not really going to hear too much from him. It's just you're going to see the results on the court. He's going to work his ass off. He's going to do well with his teammates. He's going to be very well coached, and I think he fits well in New York. New York, again, is a team that doesn't exactly have a star player that could be potentially on his way out. They're not really in that situation. They're just a team you had expectations for that they're not meeting. And if why re-sign Mitch Robinson if this is the roster you have right now? You know, yeah. Obi Toppin is coming off the bench. Would he be a starter in Indiana? Still not 100% sure based on how their roster would look if they had Mitch Robinson and Miles Turner. Again, you mentioned if Sabonis is gone, so is Turner. But we have to go with how what's on the current roster right now. But if I'm the Knicks, I'm getting on the phone, and I'm not really getting being too scared to trade some of my young pieces because I don't exactly know if they're truly Thibodeau guys, which surprises me for Mitch Robinson because I thought he was the biggest winner of Tom Thibodeau becoming their head coach. Yeah. But if I could move some of those young assets, I would do it in an absolute heartbeat if I'm the New York Knicks.
Yep, it'd definitely be a great destination spot, and I think it's a legitimate one too, because Leon Rose, I think that is kind of an X factor. When he came into this position, people really thought that that was going to be a guy that would bring over the stars, and obviously we didn't see that in this first offseason, but that would be a trade, again, that's a marquee type of trade that would really make New York maybe a spot for other free agents to, you know, dip their toes into the water. Yeah. On top of the fact, it would just make them a better overall team than they are right now.
So you haven't said my number one yet.
Yep. The number one.
Do we have this? We might have the same.
My number one is Charlotte. You brought it up earlier.
You have not mentioned my team yet. I'm looking.
My number one is Charlotte. It's got to be Charlotte. I brought it up earlier with my points. They haven't had a true center. I don't even know when the last time they had a true center was. And while I say true center, it's a long time ago. Long, long time. We're talking about that's a decade ago. But
Bismack
Biyombo, Mason Plumlee, Vernon Carey, PJ Washington, they need an upgrade. And if you could give me three stars all under the age of 25, where you have LaMelo Ball, Miles Bridges, the way he's playing, you're talking about winning most improved player of the year. I think you might have that locked up already. On top of the fact you had Sabonis to that, 18 points per game, 11 rebounds per game, and consistency and durability, which is something that this team has also missed for Charlotte, that is huge. That makes them a difference maker on top of the fact where they sit right now. That only project them even higher. And we talked about Terry Rozier earlier. It feels like the guy's been in the league forever. Alec, he's only 27 years old. He's only 27. So such a youthful team and could be around for a very, very long time. And I think that would be a key acquisition to make them a true difference maker in the Eastern Conference.
So my number one team is my biggest surprise in the NBA this year. Now, obviously, they were going to need some guarantees with another player on this team. But if they can find a way to keep Bradley Beal long-term, Washington's got some trade assets.
They do.
You look at Kyle Kuzma, who stepped up in a big way since the trade from the Lakers.
Mm-hmm.
Montrezl Harrell's been a freaking monster this year down low.
Yep.
You look at some of the other pieces around Beal. I mean, obviously, some of the young guys, Avdija and Kispert. I don't think Avdija is amazing. I also, he never played. He's replaying recently.
Yeah.
He's got a lot of minutes recently. But again, he's behind Beal, Caldwell Pope, and Kuzma. And there's not, he's coming off the bench. Maybe he could be a guy included in a deal. Corey Kispert was a 3-point shooter they added in the draft last year. A sneaky name who still isn't healthy, but Rui's been 13-6 back to back years. On a team that's had, you know, obviously other scorers on the roster. So I think if he was to switch teams, he's a 17-7, 17-8 type of guy if he was to play for a team like the Pacers. So when you look at packaging a deal that can include a Kuzma or a Harrell or a Hachimura, you know, throw in some of the other young pieces there, keep Beal in town, add a Sabonis, that's a hell of a duo there in Washington.
Yeah, that would be nice. I like that trade a lot. Again, the only thing with Washington is, again, they're not necessarily a big move splash type of team. In fact, the last couple of years, it seems like they're the ones losing the star assets, not the ones bringing them in. And I just don't see, again, while they want to keep Beal, just like Damian Lillard, he's a guy that's basically been very vocal about it, and he's not looking to go anywhere. And while Sabonis is a great player, I don't know if Sabonis is the guy that's like, oh, I gotta stay now. Especially Bradley Beal, who's an aging player. Like, he's getting to the point where he can be a key part of a championship team. He's not looking for, all right, let's do a semi-rebuild. Let me add a young talent player. In the Eastern Conference, adding Sabonis to the Wizards team doesn't do anything. Bradley Beal leaving the Wizards, that'll do something for another team. But I don't think that necessarily does that much. And I don't know if the Wizards, obviously, they don't think like that. But at the same point in time, while they have the young assets that they have not been healthy. You know, Advia has not been great. Hachimura has been injury prone, and a Kispert has not looked great so far this year. And again, still very youthful player, first year player. But Kuzma, again, one really good season this year. And before LeBron came to the party, he had a good rookie season. I don't really know. I don't really know if that'd be enough to honestly get the deal done for Domantas Sabonis.
I think obviously the two centerpieces would probably be Harrell and Hachimura once Hachimura is healthy.
Yeah,
I think Hachimura is quietly sweet. I think Harrell has proved that he is a really good center.
Yeah.
Again, I don't know. I just if I just feel like Beal, we've been hearing his name like Lillard for years in trade rumors.
Mm-hmm.
And if he comes back, that gives you even more reason to want to make this trade. That's why I said Beal is going to be huge, because if he doesn't come back and you get rid of all your assets to bring in Sabonis and there's no Beal, stupid.
Yeah.
But the Wizards are not terrible.
No, they're not.
And they have a star that doesn't sound like... I mean, Beal could leave tomorrow and it wouldn't surprise me. But Beal could also sign a five-year, $210 million extension, and that wouldn't surprise me at all either.
Let me ask you this before we round this out real quick, because I think Bradley Beal's contract ends in, what, like a year?
He has a player option this year, which he's likely going to decline to sign a five-year extension.
So let me ask you this. If you add Domantas Sabonis and your Bradley Beal, is that enough? Obviously, hundreds of millions of dollars are in the case scenario, but is that enough to say that this is a winning situation I can win here?
In the East, yes. I mean, you're not going to be better than the Nets or the Bucks.
Well, that's what I'm saying. I think Bradley Beal's in the situation where he's got to leave to join somebody else and be like a second, third party.
You can recruit some free agents to that team.
Maybe.
Like, when they were trying to find that next star, I mean, obviously they had John Wall, huge contract, prevented them from making any other moves other than adding another huge contract, which they added with Russell Westbrook. Surprise, surprise, he didn't work with all of his teammates.
Yeah.
You know, they let that contract go, add some other young pieces, use the flexibility to add more. I mean, again, it's Washington, D.C. It's not New York City, L.A., people aren't lining up to sign with the Wizards. It's kind of been like that for a while. But if you have Beal, add a Sabonis, speak to some free agents around the league. Again, Sabonis' contract doesn't kill you financially.
No.
Beal's extension is going to be $40-plus million a year.
Yeah.
So that's something you're going to eat, and I think the Wizards would have no problem doing that.
Yeah, like we talked about.
But that's your route to a third star, and I think that's the only way the Wizards are going to find a way to build a team around Bradley Beal. A contending team around Bradley Beal.
Yeah, like we talked about, that's probably one of the best, if not the best, contracts in all of basketball for the value that you're getting in a player.
Yeah. So again, I think every single team in the league could be interested. If teams are interested in trading some mega stars, I know there's some expiring contracts for young players happening around the league. Maybe that could affect a deal if it went into the offseason. But again, the trade deadline is about a month away, February 10th at 3 p.m. Eastern. So we're going to talk a lot about trade targets here on Down the Block Sports with my buddy Kyle Russo, as well as some other things happening around the league. Kyle, before I let you go, how can the listeners keep in touch with you on social media?
So, obviously, a part of Review and Preview every Tuesday night on YouTube and on Facebook. My personal account, I'm an Instagram guy, Kyle Russo, at Kyle Russo 612. That's where you can follow me if you like what I said. You know, obviously, give me a follow. And then on Review and Preview as well, every Tuesday night, starting at 7 o'clock to 9 o'clock, talking all things sports from the basketball world to the NHL world, MLB, and obviously in the midst of the MLB, in the NFL season. We're covering a lot of NFL, Alec. You've seen it firsthand. We're covering a lot of NFL stuff these last couple weeks and for the next month or so. So that's where you can follow me. That's where you can find me. I hope you've enjoyed the content in which I brought to the table here on the Alec Walt Show. And again, Alec, I know I've said this every single time that I'm on here, but can't thank you enough for the opportunity to be on your show. Really, really happy with the shows in which I've been able to be a part of.
Awesome, man. Well, I appreciate you joining me as always. We have plenty of more basketball videos coming here on Down the Block Sports, so stay tuned. That's going to be for this episode, I guess, of the Alec Wald Show. I didn't introduce it as the Alec Wald Show, but I'm your host, Alec Wald, alongside Kyle Russo from Review and Preview Sports. Where do you believe Domantas Sabonis gets traded? Does he get traded here in the trade deadline? Does he get traded in the offseason? Does he not get traded at all? Give me your thoughts in the comment section below. Also, don't forget to like this video and subscribe to the channel for more of my exclusive content. Thank you, everyone, for tuning in, and we will see you very soon.